This sawbone shows a radial column and ulnar corner fragment. The transstyloid pin is started in the flat area of bone dorsal to the first compartment and directed to the interosseous membrane. The pin should not exit dorsally or it will interfere with the ulnar pin plate. The entry site for the ulnar corner is over the flat dorsal surface, not the distal rim. The pin is initially directed perpendicular to the bone surface, then angled proximally and slightly radially as it is inserted. The typical amount of stability that simple pinning provides can be noted. Proximally, the ulnar pin plate should be aligned with the ulnar border of the radial shaft. Because of left and right differences, an additional twist is required to contour the ulnar edge of the plate to the bone. A gradual 15-degree torsional bend is made over the proximal part of the plate using two pin clamps to contour the plate properly to the left or right arm. Occasionally, a slight amount of extension can be added simply by bending the plate by hand. The plate is then slid over the pin, pulled proximally, and secured initially with a single screw. In hard cortical bone, it is often easier to tap the proximal cortex in order to simplify insertion of the bone screw. If the ulnar corner fragment is large enough, a second pin is inserted, skipping a pinhole. A useful trick is to insert the pin until it hits the far cortex, then use a drill sheath as a drill stop so that the pin is placed only a millimeter or two beyond the far cortex. Adjacent pinholes are drilled with a zebra pin for insertion of the pin hooks. The mark indicating the proper depth of the pin is noted, and the pin withdrawn one complete pair of bands. The pin is cut a pair of bands distal to this mark, and the pin bending tool is placed so that the mark is straddled by the bottom two posts of the instrument. The initial hook is made, taking care to create a straight hook and avoid a shepherd's crook appearance. The hook is completed with a pin clamp and impacted into an adjacent pinhole. The pin impactor is rotated 90 degrees to complete final seating of the hook into the plate. The same process is repeated for the second pin. It is particularly important to get the correct length to the pins of the ulnar pin plate in order to avoid irritation to the volar structures. This is possible by using the drill sleeve to prevent overpenetration when placing the pin initially and confirming the position on the C-arm. This ensures that the mark locates the pin at the correct depth. Here you can appreciate the stability the ulnar pin plate adds compared to a simple pin. The radial pin plate is applied next. Normally, the middle of this plate sits off the radius by a millimeter or two. If excessive space is present between the radial pin plate and the bone, it usually indicates that the plate is too far proximal and should be moved to a pinhole that allows a more distal position. The plate is pulled proximally and secured initially with a single bone screw. Preferably, the first screw is placed in one of the more distal holes. As the bone screw is secured, the plate flattens, pushing the radial column fragment towards the ulna. This produces load sharing between the fragments and adds to the stability of the fixation. The process is repeated with a second zebra wire, skipping one pinhole. Again, the drill sheath is used as a drill stop to limit the pin penetration to 1 to 2 millimeters through the ulnar cortex. This is confirmed with a C-arm and allows the mark to be noted, indicating the correct final length. Adjacent pinholes are drilled for seating of the hooks. The mark on the surface of the plate indicates the correct final length of the pin. The pin is withdrawn a pair of bands and cut a pair of bands distal to this mark. The pin bending tool is used to create the hook, placing the proper length mark between the lower two posts. A pin clamp is used to complete the hook slightly smaller than the separation of the pinholes, to snap the hook into the plate. A pin impactor allows final seating of the hook into the plate. This process is repeated for the second zebra wire. Except for unusual circumstances, two pins should always be used in conjunction with the radial pin plate. The combination of the radial and ulnar pin plates provides excellent stability for fractures with a single radial column and ulnar corner fragment. As a final step, at least one additional screw is placed in both the radial and ulnar pin plates. If the pins from the ulnar pin plate were incorrectly measured and are too long, a limited volar exposure allows the protruding ends to be cut. Occasionally, the longer radial pin plate or ulnar pin plate may be needed. If the 5-hole radial pin plate is used, an additional reverse bend should be made by hand at the proximal end of the plate to contour the plate into a gentle S-shaped curve. The pin plates add a dramatic improvement to the stability of fixation as compared to simple K-wires. The final appearance of the radial and ulnar pin plate on a radial column and ulnar corner fragment is shown.